Penguin Random House Audio presents The Ugly Cry, a memoir. This is the author, Danielle Henderson. For Corey, all that we survived. Don't think I forgot about you filling a water gun with piss and shooting it at me just because it didn't make it into this book, though. Introduction. I've never seen my grandmother bake a cookie, wear a shawl, give good advice, or hug a child unprompted. I have, however, heard her curse so intensely I swear she was making some of them up on the spot, watched her obsess over horror movies with an academic intensity, and listened to her frequent lectures about the reasons every woman should not only carry a knife at all times, but also fully be prepared to use it. A man wants to put his hands on you? Carry a little secret knife. Cut his throat. Ask questions later. Her favorite TV show is The Walking Dead. She likes to confidently conjure up strategies to survive the zombie apocalypse from her wheelchair, all of them involving rigged-up weaponry and fire. She knows she would triumph after a lifelong cultural diet of Creature from the Black Lagoon, Creepshow, Hostel, and Saw. She has no problem thinking up ways to kill anything that moves. And I was raised by her. It wasn't planned that way. I had a mom once, and, along with my brother, we had a life together. When she left us at my grandparents' house for a weekend, none of us knew that she wouldn't be coming back. I certainly didn't know that I would spend the rest of my childhood with people who had already retired and thought their child-rearing days were over in the 1970s. In the whiplash of trauma and figuring out how to adjust to this new life, dropped into the care of a foul-mouthed retiree, I realized it was up to me to figure out how to survive. So I would take respite in the bathroom, the only sun-filled room in the house where I could read in relative peace. Every single person in my family yelled at me when they saw me carrying a book into the bathroom, which I did constantly. No matter what my business was in there, I usually sat on the toilet reading until my legs went numb. I shared a bedroom with Grandma, a twin bed under each window. It wasn't exactly my own space. She had already made me take down my Led Zeppelin poster, not wanting to look at those sweaty white boys on the few days a week she crawled up the steps instead of falling asleep on the couch. The bathroom was the only true privacy I had in the entire house. "Danny, no. Other people have to use the bathroom, you know," Grandma said, her lips pulling into a terse line as I walked through the living room. "So then knock," I said, annoyed. "Are you giving me lip, child? The library is right down the road. If you're in there for more than 10 minutes, I will knock down that fucking door, little girl," Grandma called after me. When I wasn't letting my legs atrophy on the can while I finished chapter after chapter, I pulled back the shower curtain and climbed into the old bright blue clawfoot tub, using any towel hanging up behind the door as a pillow. I fell asleep in there once and woke up to Grandma standing over me. All of the skeleton key locks had long been painted over in this old house, none of the doors locked. It was easy to burst into any room if, like Grandma, you didn't value basic human privacy as a rule. "Oh no, you are not allowed to sleep in the tub and hold this goddamn bathroom hostage when you have a perfectly good bed upstairs." She was pulling down her polyester elastic waist pants before I could even fully get the sleep out of my eyes, and farted loudly as she sat down on the toilet. "Ew, Grandma," I yelled, scrambling to stretch my long leg over the side and get out of the tub. "Should have thought about that before you stayed in here for 2 hours," she said, gently unfurling some toilet paper. "You can sleep anywhere, but this is the only place I can shit." Chapter 1. My mom and dad met in drum corps. I have no idea what instrument he played or even if he was any good. It would be weird if I did, since I don't even know what he looks like. His name was Carlton. He lived in Newburgh, about 40 minutes away from Greenwood Lake, the small New York town where my mother grew up. They met at a parade. My grandmother didn't know that my mom had a boyfriend until he showed up to take her to her junior prom. There's a picture of them from that night, one of the only ones to survive my grandma's wrath. Mom was wearing a floor-length white dress with navy blue polka dots, afro picked out as wide as her shoulders. My dad was tall and handsome in his brown corduroy suit, the wide collar of his white button-down threatening to consume his shoulders. His afro was smaller, but the flash cube from the camera made the product in his hair glisten. In true 70s style, the photo is blurry and grainy, I can make out his features, but they don't add up to anything more than a generic face. They stood in front of my grandparents' fireplace for the photo, wide-eyed and slightly smiling. My dad was a year older than my mom, and when he graduated from high school, his family moved to North Carolina. My grandmother chalked up their relationship to a high school romance and didn't really think of it again. She told my mom to get over it. But my mom was not over it, not in the least bit. The summer after she graduated from high school, my mom got a job dressing up as Wile E. Coyote at Jungle Habitat, a Warner Brothers theme park over the Greenwood Lake border in West Milford, New Jersey. The park was filled to the brim with wild animals, and the main attraction seemed to be that you could watch them roam freely as you carefully cruise by in your car. As you can imagine, this was an idea with a terribly short shelf life. Jungle Habitat closed within a few years amid a litany of persistent scandals. One man was attacked by a lion shortly after the park opened. Another woman was bitten by an elephant. Several of the animals got out and were found wandering around residential areas nearby. My mom's summer job was to dress up like a cartoon and welcome families to this pending horror show, probably taking bets with her coworkers about which of them would come out unscathed by the end of the workday. At the end of the summer, after she had saved what she thought was enough money to survive, my mom packed a suitcase. She left it behind the shed in the backyard, which was rarely used, so she knew it would be safe. She hitched a ride to work with some friends and came home like everything was normal for the next few days. Then, one morning after she had confirmed plans with my dad, whom she'd been in touch with all along, she grabbed her suitcase, acted as though she was leaving for work, and instead took a bus into New York City and another bus from the Port Authority down to North Carolina. At 19, she had decided that her life was her own, and she was going to use it to chase a man. For decades after, my family would ask, what happened to make her like this? Mom had a run-of-the-mill, 2.1 kids, stay-at-home mom kind of family. The kids wore matching outfits for the annual family photo at Sears and were surrounded by cousins, aunts, and uncles at summer barbecues. Grandma had been a different kind of parent to her than she was to me. When I complained about mildly blurry vision as a teenager, Grandma told me that my eyes were fine and, that's what you get for reading those fucking books all night when you should be asleep. When Mom needed glasses as a kid, Grandma actually got them for her. Running away was an abnormal event in such a normal childhood. Decades later, my grandma still asks herself what happened, a bubble of self-indictment quietly rising to the surface as she wonders out loud. She was raised in the same house as your aunt and uncle. I just don't understand, she whispers, actively searching for a place to lay blame. For the rest of their lives, they would never receive a satisfying answer. My grandparents didn't know where my mom was for 3 months. It was so well orchestrated that when she disappeared, nobody suspected a thing. My grandparents, assuming she was dead on the side of the road somewhere, waited for the day they'd get a call telling them her remains had been found. Grandma started going gray. Granddad stopped talking. It probably took 10 years off of all our lives, my grandma said, recounting those months. I was a wreck. Your grandfather was a wreck. Renee and Bobby were so sad. Fucking selfish in the end, you know? All that misery for a penis. After contacting the police and filing a missing persons report, my family sat and waited. It wasn't until my grandma got the idea to check the phone bill that they got any relief. I saw all of these long-distance calls from around the time she went missing. I thought, who the hell is she calling? So I dialed the number, and she picked up, my grandma said. Just as happy as a clam, like nothing had happened. I said, Robin, where the fuck are you? She told me she was in North Carolina with Carlton. Grandma was getting annoyed retelling the story. I don't know why, but I asked her, are you pregnant? She said yes, just like that. I told her she better fucking stay there and slammed down the phone. My grandma seethes with anger when she tells this story, even now, almost 50 years later. I didn't raise my children to be like that. My older brother, Corey, was born in February 1976. My father was already cheating on my mom by then, and her life in North Carolina was bleak. She lived in a trailer with my dad on his family's property in a rural town. She couldn't afford the hospital bill after Corey was born, so she called her grandmother, Sweetie Pie, to wire her some money via Western Union so that she could take him home. He was all she had. She was so lonely she rarely put him down. But even when she held him, he cried mercilessly. She was exhausted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.